I feel like a matador, like a gay matador. The day I'm going to post this, if I get my schedule right, is the 18th of November, which is International LGBT STEM Day, a tasty eight-letter acronym of a day that is there for us to celebrate and recognise people who are in the fields of science, technology, engineering and maths, and who are also part of the LGBTQ plus community. But don't worry, there isn't a sell-by date on being queer and proud, so this video is kind of evergreen, or ever rainbow. It's watchable any time of the year. Days like LGBT STEM Day are important because representation is important. Now, we've all heard this before, I imagine, and it's that seeing as many types of people as possible in a particular field allows everyone else to see their potential place there. But I don't think I personally understood quite how important representation was until I came out, or I guess more importantly, until I realised that I hadn't come out yet. I hadn't recognised my own sexuality, but that was because I was so sure that I was straight. I don't know why I'm laughing about that now, it's because it's kind of funny. No, I was so sure I was straight because I hadn't seen any queer women out there like me. In my mind, as stereotypical as it was, from what I'd seen, I thought there was a particular way that queer women looked and acted, and to be honest, kind of felt, and I didn't match any of those three things as far as I could tell. And it's hard enough not really seeing representations of your personality in a career that you're going to go into, you know, when you sense that your approach means you're not like other scientists or not like other educational YouTubers. But it's a whole other kettle of fish when that thing you're not seeing is a key facet of your identity that can really cast your sense of self into a state of disarray. So that's why representation in general is important. But it's especially important to highlight diverse voices now because there's very few of them when we look to history. And what there is often layered in mystery or secrecy or sadness. It's almost like we need to make up for lost time or make up for the sexual identities that have been lost to time. Because we know statistically that there will have been key historical figures in STEM fields who were LGBTQ+, even if the environment they were in prevented them from showing it, or the filters their stories have been put through have caught those aspects and kind of removed them. So when it comes to historical figures, if we get any kind of whiff that anyone may have been queer, even if it's just a tiny little bit of evidence that's managed to come through history, that's still huge, considering, well, how illegal such ghastly practices as being gay were. And they still are in some places, which is a whole other issue to talk about. Take Leonardo da Vinci, for example, the incredible artist, scientist, and inventor who painted the Mona Lisa.
Who painted the Mona Lisa? Mona Lisa.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Da Vinci?
We're given a clue to his queerness in history's favourite way. Criminal charges. When he was 24, he was accused of sodomy, aka sleeping with another man, twice, but the charges were dismissed because there wasn't enough solid evidence. In his books, Da Vinci wrote almost as if he was celibate, and some people theorised that he was, but maybe it was because he was nervous about his sexual tendencies because of those criminal accusations. Because if he was pursuing relationships with men, it wasn't like he was going to leave any trace of them, especially written down where someone can find them and then put them in front of a court. There are other clues though to his sexuality, less solid ones. For example, he had close relationships with his male apprentices. In his notebook, sketches of men often appear naked, whereas women nearly always appear clothed. My girlfriend actually saw an exhibition of his work at the Louvre in February this year and said that there were sketches of naked women, but they just weren't very good, especially compared to his sketches of naked men. Whilst many historians agree that Leonardo was almost certainly not straight, we can't know for certain. And I know that this lack of certain evidence will be enough for people to say, oh well, he was probably straight then, wasn't he? Because of course straight is the default position. But if he was gay, who can blame Da Vinci for keeping things under wraps? Queer trailblazers of history who've been discovered, no matter how excellent their minds, were made to suffer. A famous example is of course Alan Turing. He was a genius codebreaker who was pivotal in helping the Allies win the Second World War. But he was sterilised, as in chemically castrated, when he was found with another man. 2 years later, he killed himself. A bitter end for a war hero. And so when we are given our gay stars of history, such as Turing, we're also given a reminder of how we've been historically punished for being who we are. Even less disgusting examples are ultimately sad tales of love that never could be. Take, for example, Margaret Mead. She was an anthropologist who studied lots of things, including whether gender roles were written into our genes. By studying groups of people across the world, most notably in Samoa, she realised that biology did not dictate that women were carers and men were protectors. She also investigated whether monogamy is inbuilt, or again, if that's a cultural societal thing. Despite the value of her theories, it is worth noting that when we look at her work through the lens of today, we can see that it has quite strong colonial tones, especially in the way that she describes kind of these groups that she visits as primitive. I mean, come on, Margs, be honest with yourself. It sounds like they had more forward-thinking viewpoints about some things than we did. Maybe we're the sociologically primitive ones. Think about that. On her sexuality though, despite being married 3 times to men, obviously, Margaret's longest lasting and most intense relationship was with another woman called Ruth Benedict. We know about it from the reams and reams of letters they wrote to each other, some of which you can see in a website that I've linked below. Quotes include, "She was American, but for your sake, I'm not going to do a prolonged American accent. I'll awaken some mornings just loving you frightfully much in some quite new way. The centre of my life is a beautiful walled place, if the edges are a little weedy and ragged. Well, it's the centre which counts, my sweetheart, my beautiful, my lovely one." And in one of her final letters to Ruth, "Always I love you, and realise what a desert my life might have been without you." So romantic, so cute, so secretive and hidden and sad. Imagine if she could have just been with Ruth, imagine how nice it would have been then. That would have been grand. And we see this kind of historical secrecy even in more recent examples. Sally Ride was the first American woman to travel into space and the youngest US citizen to do so as well. She is not, however, who the song Ride Around Sally is written about. She died in 2012, and it was only after that it was revealed that she'd spent the previous 27 years of her life in a relationship with another woman. So yeah, historically, LGBTQ plus representation in STEM fields isn't really ideal. And you'll notice I haven't given examples of scientists in every group in the community. Notably, I haven't mentioned any trans individuals because history has very much erased their presence and their contribution. Saying that, I did find one example that I didn't want to put with the other, because I feel like it has a bit more of a happy ending. Alan Hart was a pioneer of using x-rays to detect TB, and he helped implement TB screening programs that saved thousands of lives. When he was about 27, he became one of the first trans men to undergo a hysterectomy in the United States. After that, he declared he was happier since he'd made that change than he ever had been in his life, and he would continue that way as long as he lived. Another gap you'll notice so far is the lack of presence of people of colour. Their contributions to science and technology throughout history are more likely to be erased anyway, so when you're a queer person of colour, you face a double dose of deletion. This is all why being aware of the silencing and straightening and whitening of history is so important. It can give us drive to work to ensure that we don't see history repeat itself from now onwards. So, why was that such a quiet clap? So, let's do just that. Let's look at a few modern day scientists who are out, proud, and crushing it in their fields. You've got Hontus Farmer, a black trans woman, theoretical physicist, lecturer at Elmhurst University in Illinois, and volunteer for LISA, a laser antenna which is a hashtag collab between NASA and the European Space Agency. She wants scientists to be aware of the vastly different backgrounds that their peers may have. She reckons the best thing others can do is recognise the broad experiences that people may have, and still treat everybody equally despite that range of experiences. Speaking of lasers, Nergis Mavalvala is a queer Pakistani mother of two who also works with them. She's one of the stalwarts. How do you say that word? Stalwarts. She's one of the. I might just avoid saying it. She was one of the key figures in the study of gravitational waves, having had a role in the very first detection of them. She's a professor of astrophysics at MIT and also has worked at Caltech. Both quite impressive unis, as far as I know, from across the pond. She's also done other cool stuff related to laser cooling. I have no idea. Her Wikipedia was quite a lot of words I just didn't understand. But hey, she's very impressive. From lasers then to the brain and me leaning nonchalantly on my bed. Next up, we've got Kayla Singleton, who's a developmental neuroscience researcher and is also the co-organizer of the Twitter hashtag, #BlackAndNeuro. It may just be my tweet chamber, but I've seen this a fair bit and it's a great way to find new accounts. It's fab. She's a black queer woman who's currently studying Menk's disease, a childhood neurodegeneration disorder. And we all know how interested I am in neurodegeneration. I'm not gonna lie, looking at her website and her Twitter feed, may have developed a slight crush on her. Let's move on. Lynn Conway is an inventor and computer scientist who invented some stuff I don't understand, running theme here, but what it did do is it boosted modern computer processors. She's also worked with microchip design, which she did something that then triggered a technological revolution that ultimately led to big tech startups emerging in the 80s and 90s. That's my translation of her career anyway. Not bad for someone who IBM fired in 1968 after she revealed her intention to transition. But joke's on you, IBM, because Stonewall know what's up, and back in 2009, they listed her as one of their 40 trans heroes for the 40th anniversary of Stonewall. Now at the ripe old age of 82, she can sit back happy in the knowledge that she invented something that most modern computers still use to improve their processing today. Next up, we have Mika Savin, a clinical neuropsychology student who's studying HIV-related neurological disorders. They're Indigenous Lakota and also Two-Spirit. Two-Spirit is an acknowledged third gender identity in certain Native American groups, and Two-Spirits often took particular roles in the social and cultural practices of those groups. So for example, Two-Spirit individuals would often take the role of the healer of the group. I'm still learning about it, so I don't want to say much more because I'm not fully educated on it, but it's something that I've discovered thanks to this video and I'm going to read up more on. And finally, still in the field of viruses, we have Sean Whelan. Sean's done loads of stuff. He's worked out what the Ebola virus uses to get into your cells, he's worked out how the rabies virus gets into your body, and he's also worked on sussing out some potential targets for antiviral, aka against virus, drugs. As a gay man, I think the only thing he should be proud about is the fact he's from Leeds. I'm just kidding, one of my best friends is from Leeds. Just sprinkling a bit of Lancashire-Yorkshire rivalry in there, you know, the old Lannister-Stark vibes. There are, of course, tons and tons more scientists, mathematicians and interqueers who didn't have their own wiki page or their own preformed interview, which is generally where I got these people from. And I wish I had time in this video to cover someone from every community with every background in every scientific field, but sadly, this is a tight enough turnaround as it is, to be honest. Fortunately though, there's a website that can help with that, haha. It's called 500 Queer Scientists, and it was set up by Sean Edgerton and Lauren Esposito. Sean is an infectious disease biologist, and Lauren, according to her wiki, does scorpion research. 500 Queer Scientists is a site where scientists in the LGBTQ plus community can post little profiles of themselves. And actually, the title of 500 Queer Scientists has since become a bit of false advertising because they have over 1,300 entries. They say you can find people on there with all sorts of different identities across all sorts of different fields of science at all sorts of different levels in their career. There's even a search bar you can use. It's a really fantastic site. I recommend going on and having a little poke around. One of my particular favorites is someone called Jory Mitchell, who ended her little paragraph with, "Go Bats! Go Gays!" And seeing all these people is quite a powerful thing. It reminded me of when I was at a Hayley Kiyoko concert with my sister. She's a gay singer. Hayley Kiyoko, not my sister. And as I was at this concert, I realized I was surrounded by, suddenly, for the first time ever really, by tons of people who all most likely had something very core in common with me. And it felt quite overwhelming. Looking through this website has a similar effect to that, I think, for me at least. And you know, a recurring theme in interviews with queer scientists is the importance of finding a community. If you can't find one in real life, then try to find one online. Because the comfort of having access to a group of like-minded individuals is huge. Being the only person is hard. But if you're going to be the only trans person in your office, or the only gay person, or something nicher, like the only femme lesbian, or the only butch bi girl, it makes it a lot easier to know you're not the only person, if that makes sense. You can draw on other people's experiences and on the support of a community. However, highlighting role models, finding communities, and looking through the now 1,300 and counting queer scientists is fantastic, but it doesn't necessarily change how workplaces are. There are some work environments that are going to be super supportive and fantastic places to be, but there's always going to be many that still feel unwelcoming or a bit uncomfortable, especially when you end up interacting with kind of higher levels in the hierarchy of work, where people tend to be a little bit more set in their ways. But this is where everyone else comes in. Hello, you allies out there, if you're still watching, well done for making it this far. Another thing that came up in the interviews I read was advice on how colleagues and peers can help. This was generally in the context of research labs as I was looking up scientists, but I think it can pretty much apply to any workspace. So here's what you can do to make your LGBTQ plus colleagues feel welcome. Firstly, visible messages of support can be a very small and simple but very powerful thing. Having a rainbow flag in the office or rainbow lanyards on. I used to see rainbow lanyards as a little hello, I'm gay sign, but now they seem to be more of an ally thing as well, and I do welcome that too, as long as you don't get freaked out if I start giving you the eyes. I won't give you the eyes anymore, I've got a girlfriend. Sorry, that was old me, the past me. Another thing is people highlighting their pronouns in their email signatures, for example, and in that same vein, honouring the pronouns that people prefer you use. Sometimes it takes a little bit of practice, and that's okay, but just try, because it'll make them feel far more comfortable. These are such small things that to a lot of people would go by unnoticed, but I promise when it relates to you, it's almost like you're hyper aware of if there's any of those signals around. Like honestly, since coming out, I've realized what a relief it is when I see the pride rainbow in a new space. And sorry, I don't mean like corporate rainbows like Starbucks rainbow or even the NHS rainbow, sorry, still of the health service, but it's not quite the same. Seeing a pride flag is such a comfort because it's a signal, and some people see it as performative, but really I think it's a great first step in making people feel welcome. Another thing that makes people feel valued is when their colleagues, especially their superiors, take issues related to them seriously. Call out homophobic behaviour, be it obvious or subtle. Let your colleagues know that it won't be tolerated and that you've got their back. There is a difference, I feel, between actively showing support and not just minding if it comes up that someone's gay. Be willing to learn, and most importantly, just approach any new situation, even if it feels quite unknown to you, with an open mind and with kindness. And finally, just remember, in any team, whether it's science, tech, engineering, maths, or anything, you want a group of people with as broad a range of experiences as possible to get the best possible results. Every person will look at a problem slightly differently, and so may find slightly different ways to solve issues that you may not have thought of yourself. And that is where the true value of diversity of all kinds comes in. Oh, and that is it! A whistle-stop tour of some of science and maths' LGBTQ plus figures from history and today. Happy Pride in STEM Day, everyone! Or I suppose, happy any day. It's been a bit of a different video from me, obviously on a topic that's quite close to my heart and not just because of this pin, but I've really enjoyed making it, even though it was a bit of a tight turnaround, so I hope you've enjoyed watching it too. If you have, like this video if you like it, share it if you share it, subscribe it if you subscribe it, comment if you have any thoughts, and medium my socials if you want to do that. Otherwise, all that's left to say is thank you so much for watching, have a lovely day, and remember, go Bats! Go Gays! And a huge thank you to my wonderful patrons, with a special shout out to Justin Brown, Terry Cox, and Adam Dullinger. Did it in reverse this time to mix it up. Roll up, roll up, roll up. You've got... I made a terrible mistake and just scratched this before I'm about to film. No! Ding, ding, ding. Criminal charges. So, on that topic, quiet clap so it's not too loud on the mic. Make it gay, make it gay. With respect, I would hope. Stalwarts, you're the one of the stalwarts. Should I drink out of this? Should have seen that coming, really, shouldn't I? And that's it, it's over. But if for some bizarre reason you don't want it to be, then here's a playlist of my favourites of my own, and here's a specially picked out video just for you. Bye!